Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God. Believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I'm going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come. I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even though they die. And whoever lives in me, and whoever lives, will never die. We offer our deepest condolences to family and members of the family of our deceased brother, Wendell Euclid Harvey, known as Dodo. Dearly beloved, we are gathered today to pay our final earthly tribute of respect to that which was mortal, our deceased brother and friend. To you, the members, his fiance, his brothers, his sisters, those close to him, those who are feeling his pain even now, who mourn his loss, we especially offer you deep and sincere sympathy. May we share with you the comfort afforded in God's word. Let us pray. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we come into the sanctuary this evening filled with sorrow, realizing our utter dependence upon you. O God, we know you do love us and can turn even the shadow of death into the light of morning. Help us now to wait before you with reverent and submissive hearts, knowing, Father, that you are our refuge and strength. O God, a very present help in time of trouble. So this evening, grant unto us your abundant mercy. Father, may those who presently mourn today find comfort and healing in your sustaining grace. Father, we humbly bring these petitions in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Our first hymn, which will be led by our first lesson, is by Sheila Doman, and then our chairperson of leaders. It's taken.
Good evening, church. We are here to celebrate and give thanks for the life of Wendell. The scripture reading will be taken from the New King James Version, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 6 to 8, and John chapter 11, verses 23 to 27. So we are always confident, knowing that while we are at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord. For we walk by faith, not by sight. We are confident. Yes, please rather be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. Jesus said to Martha, "Your brother will rise again." Martha said to him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? She said to him, Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ. Here ends this scripture reading.
Good afternoon to the church. Good afternoon. Good afternoon. We are here to celebrate the life of Lendell Euclid Harvey, known to some of you as Dodo. So we're going to sing lustily this evening as we celebrate his life. And the song, To God Be the Glory. Great things he has done. So loved he the world that he gave us his son, an ultimate gift. Amen. To God be the glory, great things he has done, so long. We're now going to invite Kathy Ann Brown as she delivers a tribute. Kathy Ann Brown.
Good evening, everyone. Although his name was Wendell Harvey, this sounds so strange to me. We all called him Dodo. Thinking back, I struggle to remember my first interaction with Karen and Dodo. I guess as you get to know people, you assume that they would always be around. I know it was when they first moved into Lancaster Phase 2. However, I clearly remember my first conversation with them. One evening, I had stopped by their house on the way home and welcomed them to the neighborhood. She introduced herself as Karen and said to me, "This is Dodo." I thought to myself, how could she refer to this poor man as Dodo? Especially seeing that he was her partner and that he also only had one hand. I was puzzled. I felt pity for him because how I assumed things to be. No, I saw them several times after that and refused to join her in calling him Dodo. So I referred to them as a couple, as neighbors. "Hey neighbors, how y'all doing?" That kind of thing. Let me tell you, the joke was on me. There was definitely no reason to pity Dodo. Although he was an amputee, he never once sat back and expected anyone to do anything for him. Early every morning, he was up and outside the house, doing some kind of work. From fixing any and everything to building the table and benches that we spent many nights hanging out on, and climbing the ladders to wash down the house, to wash down the windows, and even painting the house. He was knowledgeable in almost all things construction, and what he didn't know, he knew someone who knew it. A standing joke amongst us was that if there was any work going on in the neighborhood, you can find him. It didn't matter who the house belonged to, it didn't matter what was actually being done, he would turn up. One Sunday morning, we decided to test this theory, and my son Ryan went outside and started to pound a hammer. Sure enough, Dodo appeared a few moments later to find out what was going on and to lend a hand. When we told him we knew he would turn up, he just stood there and laughed. He was that person. Someone you could rely on at any time and never expect anything, and he never expected anything in return. And I'm sure that many of our neighbors would echo that sentiment. No, I didn't know anything about football, but I can say I know about his team, Manchester United. And trust and believe almost everyone in the neighborhood would know when football was playing. Both Dodo and Stefan could be heard shouting at his TV like lunatics. So when I saw his coffin, I smiled. This is him. The speed at which we got to this point to be here this evening, paying our final respects, still has a lot of us in shock. The grief of losing a life partner, Karen, Stefan, a father, a son, a brother, an uncle, a friend, can be overwhelming. But take solace in the fact that he made his mark. He was here.
Thank you, Kathy Ann. We're now going to invite Jaleesa Edwards to deliver her tribute. Jaleesa Edwards.
Good evening, everyone. Just give me a minute. This is very hard. We are gathered here to celebrate the life of Wendell Euclid Harvey, also known as... We are gathered here this evening to celebrate the life of Wendell Euclid Harvey, better known as Dodo. He was the son of Juliet Alexander and the late John Boyce, brother of Christopher, Elvis, Dexter, and Sean. He was also the father of Stefan and life partner of Karen. He was educated at St. Lucie Primary and then on to St. Lucie Secondary. He was raised in Six Men's. You all know that. He would let you know where he came from. With his father, John, who was known as Ashby. Anyone that had known him would agree that he was the most loving and funniest person you would ever meet. Naldo was lured into my family through the help of my late grandmother and my mother some 25 years ago. Naldo was working in the area cutting trenches, or as he would like to say, finding pipes for our Barbados Water Authority.
Or bursting them.
Yes, bursting them. My late grandmother would always say to him, "Little boy, that tractor is too big for you." And she would chat with him from time to time. And eventually, they had befriended each other, along with my mother. He finally became confident enough to inquire about my cousin Karen, who had caught his eyes, and even asked if she was seeing anyone. To which my mother would reply, "No, but you could try your luck." And she would put in a word for him. Now every lunch hour was spent at our house. And every day from then on, he would use the excuse of coming for a glass of water and an update.
That's a good excuse.
I've never known a man to drink so much water. My mother then relented and gave him our number and told him to call her. Karen then came to my mother and said, "This fellow below, that working below the house, call me." And my mother replied, "For true?" Knowing fully well she had given him that number. And the rest is history, as they said. And since then, the request for water stopped. He then became a father and raised his son, Stefan, to the man he is today. They both shared many memories and a passion for football. Their favorite team, Manchester United. So all those wearing blue in here.
Wrong color.
Wrong color. Yeah. It was well known to anyone who met him. Dodo was also the unofficial assistant coach at Old Trafford. And everyone in the district knew of his coaching skills because they could hear him screaming at the TV along with Stefan. All of their celebrations and their critique on every match. Who then subbing next season? Who then firing? It was all said. He was a man unlike any. Where many fell, he rose. He was unstoppable. For example, when he lost his right arm in an accident, it didn't stop him. You would still see him, as Gaffey said, with a hammer, a saw, and unbelievably, this man never missed a nail. He also formed a group with the guys from Six Men called the Butchers Inc., such as Kenny, Nolan, and Troy Burt, to name a few. He was a man of the community, and the community loved him back. And anyone from Lancaster can affirm this. He was a friend. He was a brother, a cousin, and many other things. Also a tradesman. Would like to share with you two funny moments among our memories, I would like to say, among my family and Dodo. From the time and the adventures he would share with my cousin, for example, one time he took her fishing. And after hours and hours of casting line, she jumped with elation. I caught a fish. It was a bag of garbage. But anyway, Dodo always saw a silver lining. She caught something. From his diva moments at home, where you would find him styling around the house, to his words of encouragement, even when you fumbled. For example, if you were in the kitchen and you forgot something on the stove and you burnt it, he would say, "Jay, it's not burnt, it's just well done." Guys, in this box lies the body of Wendell Euclid Harvey, but it does not house his spirit. For his spirit is where? Not in heaven as yet, it's at Manchester United, guiding those cleats. Win after win, we will hold that Champion Cup. He's gone now, but he sits and waits for us all. And until we see him again, with a smile plastered on his face, and the stories he will continue to tell. Friends, this is not goodbye. This is until we meet again. Thank you. Rest in peace, my brother.
Thank you, Julissa. The next song, Heaven's Jubilee, is a song that was specifically requested by the family. And we didn't make it known that we were not 100% familiar with it. So they have agreed to come and lead us in. So please come. And while they're coming, Julissa, is this a question, Julissa? Okay. Julissa is a Manchester United fan too. I picked up that. She was speaking for herself too. So what are you gonna do? Just start it and maybe we get the tune and move on. So come, no, come from here. Come here.
Shall sing in Jesus in the air, coming after you and me. Joy is earth. Sunshine.
As you were standing, let's sing that one. I'll fly away. I think it's here in our hymnal. Here in our. I'm sorry. I didn't see it. Or you may be seated. Some glad morning when my life is over.
Some glad morning when this life is over. Cover this entire family, cover the six men's community. Father, cover Lancaster, Father. Just cover all the friends who are in mourning and bless those hands who are here to provide for the building of your kingdom. Father, just bless this offering and give everyone here a double portion of blessing. All these things we ask in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Blessed good evening to you. If you were to check back your diaries for the beginning of January, this date was not placed in your diary in relation to the celebration service for Wendell you claim Harvey or Dodo. This date was not in your diary to be at the Westmoreland Church of the Nazarene wishing our departed brother goodbye. It just reaffirms what the scripture says, that we know not the time, the hour, or the date when our life will be taken from us. And since we know that to be a fact, what type of people ought we to be? We have the information. Actually, it was reflecting that you shouldn't pass, you shouldn't fail an exam if you have the answers. If you're providing the answers for an exam, it occurred to me you shouldn't fail it, right, Nisha? Although you say that some open book exams are harder than some exams that you study for. So the scripture gives us answers for questions as it relates to us human beings. So whereas it is true that no part in your diary was written in Dodo's funeral, no part of your diary was written in at Westmoreland Nazarene this date in May. Because as I said earlier, we don't know the time. But the scripture says to us very clearly, unambiguously. The scripture says to us, actually in Hebrews 9:27, and I'm inclined to say this, I said it in the last thing we had here a couple days ago, that it really is appointed unto each one of us. It's appointed for each one of us today. And I need that to settle in your spirit. Because not settling your spirit from a standpoint of fear, but settling your spirit from a standpoint of what preparation you're going to make. As I reflect on life and death, we make a lot of preparations. Let me do some of the preparations we make. We prepare for our insurance. So we have insurance policies. We insure for our family. We try to get things in place. So there's a lot of material preparation. There's a lot of preparation that has no heavenly value, even though it may be necessary in our earthly sojourn. So as church, we have to remind persons in these occasions that the message of the scripture is still true. It's not a Nancy story. It's not a piece of literature that no longer bear relevance to our generation. It is not dead literature that no longer has life and meaning. Because actually, as one examines the scripture, one is moved to find out that it is the most authentic body of work than any other place. Nothing the Bible predicts about concerning man has not happened or is not happening. But the Bible is one of the books that are not dated. Karen called me totally broken. Can it happen so quickly, Pastor? Pastor, can you be here? And in a couple of days, this happened? Totally confused in her mind how life can move to death so rapidly before warning. And the scripture tells us that the authenticity of the scripture as it relates to humanity is spot on. All other books, all other body of work will be dated. But this book that addresses you and I at that deep personal level reminds us that we too have an appointment. And actually, I don't mean to be morbid, but church is one of the places we have to remind humanity about the truth. Because out there, we're given the impression that we'll live forever. Actually, living forever is a very marketable, product. Living forever is a marketable product. You're told that this tablet gives you 10 more years. This product keeps your skin toned from wrinkling. This This other one keep your hair black. So longevity, there's a market for the sale of longevity. We are scripture in its simple, unambiguous form, relevant for every generation, still remains quietly after the long talk. But remember, John, what will it profit a man if out he gained the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what can a man give in exchange for his soul? So as we celebrate Dodo's life, it is a powerful moment for us to reflect on our life, knowing that this is a journey that each one of us will have to make. And to become more clear, those of us who were born in the 1900s, I really want to push it home to you. I want to push it home to you because it is important that we have some personal introspection on our earthly journey. Because sometimes these are the things we don't think about. Kieran, let's talk. Death was not part of your whole conversation. Life and future plans and happiness and joy. And that is the way it should be. But instead, the monster of death, and the scripture reminds us, in Corinthians chapter 15, verse 22, it says, "For as in Adam all died, even so in Christ all shall be made alive." So there's relevance then in seeking out who this Jesus is. There's relevance in finding out who is this one that is associated with life. The scripture said, well, in him is life, and you can have that life abundantly. So I want to get it deep into the recesses of your heart to pay attention to the scripture. Pay attention to the word of God. You may hear many stuff, but it is still very relevant because it speaks specifically to human beings. And you know why it's always relevant? It's always relevant because about every 40 to 45 years, the earth has a whole new group of people you're speaking to. About every 40 to 45 years, there are thousands of new persons around. Do you know that there are not many persons around who were born in 1920? And do you know that what happened to those in the 2030s? And in the 2040s? But where's that, Pastor? Because the scripture is true. It's appointed unto man once again. And in the 2040s, you know, at one point in time, there'd be no persons around who were born in the 1940s. You know, at some point in the future, there'll be no person around who was born in the 1950s or 60s. Where we get that information from? It comes from the word of God, the authenticity of the word of God. And do you know that it's not just peculiar to us here in Barbados, that is true to any other part of the world? The universality of the accuracy of the word of God is not applicable just to this location, but no part of the world would you find an abundance of persons living in those spirits. I mean, I came from the scripture. So there is truth in the scripture. There is truth in the scripture. It's appointed unto man. And it also said in the scripture, remember not a creator in the days of their youth. He must be really like Manchester United for truth. And I learned that you like Manchester United too. Actually, pick it from your voice. But I encourage you to, actually, a few things came to my mind as I was listening. As I listened to Kathy Ann, it occurred to me that whatever apprehension she had in her initial meeting of her neighbor, she became the person using the eulogy. After how many years is that in the new community you're in? 5 years. In 5 years, Kathy Ann was transformed. To stand and say, of a truth, I was touched by this life. Jalisa spoke of his loyalty. And I want to give you a little story about loyalty. Recently, I read a story of a manager who was leaving his company. He spent the evening doing some late work in the company, so he was about to leave now. And as far as he was concerned, he was the last person in the complex. So as he got to the guardhouse, he said, "Guard, no one else is here. I'm the last person, so you can close off." The guard said, "No, sir. Someone else is still there." He said, "I told you, no one else is here. The last 3 hours I alone was here. You can close off." And the guard insisted, "Mr. Manager, no, someone else is still there." "How do you know someone else is still there?" he asked. He said, "I know someone is still there because for the last 20 years, and let's use his name Joe. Whenever Joe came to work, he came and he greeted me. And for the last 20 years, when he left, he never did that before he greeted me. There was a loyalty about Joe that sustained the period of time. So Joe has not gone. What he did not stop doing in 20 years hardly would happen this evening. He's back there." So you say, "Let's go look for him then." So they went looking for him. They opened the freezer door and they caught George almost at the end of his breathing. But they were able to drag him out because his loyalty was of such that the guard was not going to take it from no one that he could have gone without having spoken to him. How loyal are you this evening? What is the measurement of your loyalty that would make persons stand up and say, no, he's still there? I kind of heard some of that when she said they're tested by beating the hammer. And that came right back to my mind. It was not my intent to speak with the loyalty, but when she said that they carried out the experiment in her, it was your son or some family member, beating a hammer to demonstrate that once Dodo hear work going in his community, he's going to gravitate towards the action with the intent of assisting. What a community testimony. What an example of loyalty to the cause. What an example of willing to be my brother's keeper. And that is what impacted my mind as she spoke. Moving from, and I don't mean to be negative in this, but moving from pity to admiration. Am I right, initial comment? From pity to admiration. And from admiration to emulation, some qualities she saw, I deduced from her comment, that are worthwhile emulating. So obviously, caring, the community are also experiencing the loss of Dodo. But with that type of spirit, we need so many Dodo spirit in communities. Because scripture is right behind that. All these things that all these virtues that we're seeing from the human experience are virtues that we're admonished to do in the Word of God. The Word of God says, "Be our brother's keeper." It says, "Who is your neighbor?" It speaks of neighborliness. It speaks of loyalty. It speaks of community, that heart of community. Once upon a time, the church was a location where the heart of community was expressed and experienced. Somehow that has begun to dwindle. I want to reintroduce you to the heart of community. I want to reintroduce you to the idea, wherever your community is, to spend some time, because the scripture, the authentic scripture, the scripture that is not dated, the scripture that is always relevant to humanity, has made some truth that keep coming to pass over and over and over again. So I want to encourage you this evening, if you've never had that relationship or that knowledge of investigating Christ and his precepts and what he said, the one who speaks of life, as Adam died, even so in Christ shall be made alive. By each to his own order. Christ the first fruit, afterward those who are Christ in his coming. Then comes the end when he delivers the kingdom of God. So I want to encourage you this evening, as you took time out to demonstrate your feeling, demonstrate your tribute to the life that you experience, to the life that touched you. May you also have that attribute to touch others' life. There's a song that says, if I can touch somebody, or if I can help somebody, as I do what? As I pass along, then my living shall not be in vain. And that was one of the attributes of Jesus himself. Even in the face of disciples who were very touchous, Jesus said, I need to pass this direction to touch this life. I need to pass that direction to give help to another life. I pray that you would take the baton that Dodo might have left, that baton of compassion, that baton of community, that baton of helping each other. What has happened nowadays is we are more involved in what the scripture says to us not to do. The scripture says, do not store up for yourselves only treasures on earth, where moth and vermin destroy, where thieves break in and steal. The scripture says that there's not a recent quote. The scripture long ago says, listen guys, thieves will break in and steal. But suggest to you to store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where thieves are unable to break in and steal. And how do you store up those treasures? Being community minded. Understanding that there's a God to serve. Understanding that his word is still authentic in regards to what others say. And you know why his word is always authentic though? Because as we move off, every 40 years you have almost half the population across the world goes. And that new group come with some of the characteristics that we left. They still need to know to love your brother. And the scriptures are the only one that really addresses that. They still know that you, whatever things are kind, whatever things are pure, whatever things are a good report, not only think on these things, but practice these things. The scripture is the only authentic message. The scripture is not digital. It is still relevant. So each one. So regardless of whatever your station is this evening, I had a nice little scenario here yesterday, or last night. We had our youngsters last night, and they were doing some science events, and they were asking questions and laughing at each other. But one of our young people, they're sitting down, who had a degree in chemistry. But she was quiet. She was relaxed. She was listening to them. And they were almost finished. We didn't say, okay, do you know that our sister has a degree in chemistry? Let her help us with some of those whatever questions they were we're dealing with. One point I'm getting to, I'm saying to you that the level of our intellect has nothing to do with our service to God. The smart people who love the Lord, the smart people who serve the Lord. So our intellectual reason for not serving the Lord is mute. I really can find no caring. I can find no solid reason for persons not honoring and serving the creator of the universe. When you look at the authentic nature of his word, Kieran, you'll miss Dodo 5 years, and your son misses dad. Scripture also says there's a father still sticketh closer to another brother. You have a lot of friends here, and I guess family members, but none of them can touch the core of your spirit like our Heavenly Father. It's amazing because you were created in his image. Mom will do her best, I'm sure. Your sister and your children or your friends will do their best. But there's something else happened when you're on that pillar alone. and the lights are turned off, it's even then he can minister to you. That's why it's important to know him as a personal Savior. Of course, there's no question how shocked his friends are at his quick passing. A young age, I think they arithmetic to me at 48, 47, yeah, like 47, and that's young. And sometimes questions are asked, how can this be? But I'll tell you what, there's no answer to why. Really, the response to this, Lord, how can I learn from this? What lesson can I learn from this? Because why take you into a dangerous zone? You can't ask him way too much. You start to provide yourself with answers that you're erroneous. How can this be? So my prayer is that you will get the baton of the positives of his life, that the community was, what community was again in 6 weeks? Lancaster. That those of you who were touched by his life, Kathy Ann. That really caught me. Kathy Ann, maybe you and the others are responsible to make sure the baton continue to fly. What interests me though, Kathy Ann, did you ever get around to calling him Dodo? All those questions, she got around to the name that she felt so repugnant about. She found out where there's something more than a name. There's a character, there's a quality, there's a strength. And she came around. So I thought you give us a powerful lesson from moving from one point to the other. From neighbor to the one giving the final tribute. So touched you were with his lives. May that be our attitude in our community too. May that be our attitude at our workplace. May that be our attitude among our family. In this age of 2023, we are almost in a whole different space. Scripture says, break through and steal. The door lock is no safety now. Because as the scripture says, thieves are breaking through and steal. Even while you are inside. And the scripture tells us about that. So we are going to keep you in our prayers. It's not going to be easy though. Grief has a way, grief has its own way of dealing. And you can't fight it, you have to go through the process. But I encourage you to seek the strength of Almighty God. I think Psalms 46, they say he is really a refuge. He is really a strength. A mental strength, a spiritual strength, something of physical strength. Because when the inner man begins to feel strong, it has some powerful impact on the physical. And he's a present help. And there's a powerful, he's a present. People tend to run away in troubled times. Trouble is not a time that people gravitate. Trouble is a time where people speculate. The scriptures say he's a present help in the time of trouble. A young man, the qualities of your dad, on the young Sunday school boys. He's just a big boy now. But the qualities of your dad, we may not be able to understand what happened or why it happened. But God promised to be a dad. The community that you serve. So community, you have a responsibility to his son. Because it's not easy to lose a dad. So the community that he was so effective in, the community that he served so powerfully in, community, you know, have a responsibility in the rearing of this young man. Because what happens when death occurs suddenly? Well, you know, there are different studies about that, but anger, resentment, all types of things happen as the physical try to make sense of what is happening. So community, you have a responsibility to the family. So as we close this chapter, this earthly chapter, remember what the scripture says. We too have an appointment. Remember the authenticity of the word of God. Don't take it for granted. We don't know where our time is, but it has already been allocated. It's already allocated. We just don't know. We're going to have the coffee open for the final hymn. And that's the family that comes. We pray for the family before we open the coffee for the final viewing. So come, family members, just stay around here. Let's have our final prayer. And then we would, at the request of the family, open the coffin for your final viewing. Okay. You're going to need the strength of each other. But God promised to give that strength. Jesus said, "Say, you are my strength like no other. You are my hope like no other." So, Father, in this difficult moment, where loved ones feel the sense of loss and departure, may your gracious hands of comfort be present in their hearts and their minds. May they experience the tender care that only you can give when dealing with this level of hurt and this depth of pain. When dealing with unanswered questions, only you can bring solace. So would your solace and your gentleness and your kindness be the experience even now? You understand the tears. But not only you understand the tears, you're able to dry the tears. You're able to offer the deep comfort that is so necessary in this journey. So strengthen caring, Lord Jesus. Strengthen their son. Strengthen their cousins, siblings, in-laws. Strengthen the community. But as this light of help goes out, other lights will shine. Father, also allow us to pause and look at our own selves in light of your word. Let us gravitate towards life and your life. And you promise us eternal life. So let there be a new attitude and new appreciation for the life that comes from you. You promise us, Lord, that this shall not be our final sojourn. But as you rose from the dead, whosoever believe in you shall have that said experience. And we believe that at the bottom of us. You're the giver of the breath of life. So thank you for his life, Lord. Thank you for his experiences. Thank you for the spirit he demonstrated. Those who he brought joy to. Those who he helped. The positive spin on life. May the memories of his contribution to his community bring a sense of joy to his family, or rather a sense of comfort to his family. Pray for us today, in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to have a final hymn. Please stand for a final hymn. And as the family say, we'll open the casket for those who may not have made their final respect. And by the end of the song, yes. Talk to me. Okay, so you're going to put it on there. Yes, about to. Oh, okay. Okay, the process we're going to use, is those at the back who wish to or whether you have not before, come and you can have your viewing and we go through the side door.
Final song we will sing, Do Not Pass Me By.
Pass me not, O gentle Savior. Hear my humble
Savior.
We've come now to commit the body of our departed friend to his kindred dust, dust to dust, ashes to ashes.
The spirit we lead of God, for we know the merciful judge of all the earth will do right. Let us who remain dedicate ourselves anew to live in the fear and love of God, so that we may obtain an abundant entrance into the heavenly kingdom. We will sing the hymn, And Can It Be? And can it be that I should an interesting Savior's blood died he for me, his pain for me, who him to death pursue? Amazing, how can that the Almighty should die for me? Amazing love, that the Almighty God should die for me. He left his Father's throne, so free, so weak, night his grip, emptied himself, all but love, and bled for Adam, helpless race, tis mercy, for oh my God, found of me, tis mercy, for oh my God is found out. Long my prison's been, fast bound in sin and nature's night. Thine eyes diffuse a quickening ray. I woke the drums flame with light, my chains fell off, heart was free, I rose. forth and follow me. My chains fell off.
My heart was free. I rose and forth
and follow. No condemnation now I dread. Jesus and all in him is mine. Alive in it, my living it, clothing righteousness divine. Bold I approach eternal throne and claim the crown. Christ my Lord, bold I approach and claim the crown, true Christ my own. Our next hymn is when the roll is called up yonder. I'll be there. When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal, bright and fair. When the save of earth shall get over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. Oh, when the roll
is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder,
when the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder, on that bright and cloudless morning when dead in Christ and the glory of his resurrection share, when his chosen one shall gather to home beyond, oh, and the roll is called up yonder, oh, when the roll, oh, when the roll is called, oh, when the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder, so let us labor for the Master to set. Talk of all his wondrous love and care. Then when all of life is over and our work, oh, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. Oh, when the roll
is called up yonder,
oh, when the roll
is called up yonder,
when the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder, oh, when the roll
is called up yonder,
when the roll, when the roll, when the roll is called, amen. Our next hymn is when peace like a river attendeth my way. Like a river attendeth, when sorrows like sea bend,
whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well in my soul.
It is well with my soul. It is well.
It is well with my soul.
Though Satan should bow,
though trials let this blessed assurance control, that Christ hath regarded my heart.
my sin, oh, the bless of his glorious throne. Christ, the solid rock, I stand. On Christ, the solid rock, I stand. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean. When darkness seems to hide his face, I rest on him. His oath is covenant, his blood supports me. My soul gives way, he then is all my hope and stay. On Christ the soul. All other ground when he shall come with trumpet song, may I then dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand on Christ the soul. Are heavy and sad. Will you be with them, sustain and guide them in the days to come? Grant, O Lord, that they may love and serve you and obtain the fullness of your promises in the world to come. Now may the God of all peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead, O Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, equip you with everything good for doing. And may he work in us what is pleasing to him. Through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen.
Till I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. You have led me through the fire, and in darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God. 'Cause all